Astrophysical observations.
So, thank you a lot for the invitation here. I am new from this community, and so I am not an expert there is a sort of echo. Okay, I'm not an expert of quantum gravity theories, but today I learned a lot of things. I was involved with quantum gravity very briefly a lot of years ago with Dennis Sciama. I remember when he was still in CISA. But I still keep reading papers, etc. So I know some names of you, of yours. And before stopping racing cars, I went to astronomy. That's true. And then here I am. I am presenting the result of a measurement that we did with a dedicated software for Hubble Space Telescope. So reading and from the talk of this morning, as a poor astronomer like me can understand that we can present only a measurement. So we don't have, personally, I don't have the full mathematical control of all the theories involved in quantum gravity. But mathematics is so nice that I love reading those papers, at least. So what I understand and we discussed during this paper, me, Carmine, who was a PhD student, Carmine Cuofano from Naples, who worked 4 years in writing a program for Hubble Space Telescope. Massimo Della Valle worked with Perlman, who got the Nobel Prize last year, and Perlmutter. And with Adam Riess also. And then there is Roberto Gilmozzi, who is one of the head of ESO, who is interested on getting better information from single diffraction images from stars. So if you have to build, for example, big telescopes, large telescopes like the 40-meter telescope, which is going to be built in Chile, you must need to know how atmosphere or other effects are act in a destructive way. So the same approach we did for quantum gravity. So what we understand is that string theory, we did not see any supersymmetric partner yet, as far as I know. Supergravity or loop quantum gravity can be some candidates, as we understand from the outside, essentially. But, the Hitchhiker's Guide to Quantum Gravity is, as also Giovanni explained this morning, what is the characteristic energy scale of quantum gravity, and why the concept of scale is so important? So we have the classical Planck scale, or, as explained today, larger than Planck scale fluctuations. Even, I read some paper, submillimetric scales. So for us is don't panic. Maybe we can find something to do an experiment or to use some information that we get from outside, from the stars. So the implications, and this may be the reason that I am here, is those attempts of quantizing gravity sometimes or several times give up Lorentz invariance at the start. So this could be a feature of quantum gravity or a modification, as I learned today. So there are a lot of wild ideas and nice ideas on this field. And it was very interesting to attend to the lectures today. Unfortunately, I have to leave quite soon. That's why. So the scenario, usually when I explain something to the students, is with Veneziano, that started strings, extra dimensions, gravity, then supersymmetry, etc. So there are a lot of big ideas, a lot of mathematics developed over there. But I don't see logically closed theory as far as I see. So how can we move in this jungle of ideas? Maybe with the phenomenology. So let's take the simplest theories that also we can understand. So we have an instrument we use for that. We use Hubble Space Telescope, and they will explain why we need only Hubble Space Telescope, not bigger telescopes. And we try essentially to see if there are some limits, upper or lower limits, to put in the most simple scenarios from quantum gravity. Then it's when we give these results, it's the turn of the theoreticians to give a better suggestion to us. So you have to add this or to take in consideration that, etc., etc. What we start is that each quantum gravity model predicts different space and time fluctuations. Then you can describe the semi-classically as a space-time foam. But this recalls something that is quite common in astronomy. If you have a space-time foam or something that disturbs the propagation of photons, this reminds you that you have something, something under commas that looks like an atmospheric effect. So you may lose coherence from the farther sources. And this is what we can measure, or we try to do, essentially. So does this space-time foam has an effect like the atmosphere in the star when you see twinkling or blurring of a star with a normal telescope on the ground, and you get crazy to get all the iry rings or the diffraction figures that you should obtain because you have a circular aperture, you make interference, and then you should get the usual iry ring profile. But atmosphere destroys all this information and you have a loss of coherence. Let's see if we have something like that from point-like sources. And the problem is that we had to choose images by image by image. So from space-time that has a foamy structure and the idea that quantum gravity may manifest at energy much below the Planck scale, we can think that these effects can be seen also on photon propagators over long, large distances, for example, from the farthest quasars or from supernovae, very far supernovae, and observe if it is possible to see at least the degradation of diffraction images of distant sources. So the concept is to determine scales to see what photons can be can give us as information and to use the sky as a laboratory, essentially. There are possible tests, experimental tests for Lorentz invariant violations. Either you use particles or, for example, a cosmic ray, and you have the GZK cutoff on cosmic ray protons that you discussed also today, or the overabundance of gamma rays above 10 TeV from the Blaser Markarian 501. There are some active galaxies that still can give these strange results, or the electron propagation in the Crab pulsar that we will see after from Jacobson Liberati Nature paper. Or we can use, as usually astronomers do, photons. So from gamma X-ray astronomy, we can have also some information of a Markarian, or to study, for example, possible Lorentz violations from gamma ray bursts. Or we can use optics and photonics imaging. So use the light, visible or infrared light. So you don't have a very high energies in this case, but you think to get information about the space-time foam as an atmospheric effect, as I told you. So the only way to proceed in this direction is to take the images or archive images or normal images from Hubble Space Telescope, because it is the only telescope outside the atmosphere. The next step is to implement the new this software for James Webb, and the student is starting working on that. It is now a postdoc. He was a slave for 4 years of that team, but he produced a fantastic piece of software that will become available quite soon when there will be a human interface. So our question is, can we see blurred images because of quantum gravity? Before we spoke about particles. This is, for example, the work by Jacobson, Liberati, and Mattingly, when they put a strong constraint on a type of Lorentz violations with the electron propagation in the Crab Nebula, setting a maximum speed for the velocity of electron. So another result from astrophysics. Then there is someone here from the University Paris Diderot. I have seen this one observing this integral IBIS observation of the gamma ray burst, and they experimentally tested the Lorentz invariance violations in, I don't remember the date of this paper. It is after 2004, of course, because the number of the gamma ray burst. But also here, they were able to improve by 4 orders of magnitudes the existing constraints of some Lorentz invariance violations. So let's start with the photons now. So photons, I repeat, still repeat, that generated from distant sources may accumulate effects from the space-time fluctuations. So a photon with energy E can experience energy and, which is related, momentum fluctuations when space-time fluctuations are occurring at scales larger or equal to that Planck scale. This means that we can roughly do power law interpolation of these energy fluctuations 4 times bigger than a characteristic time scale, and measure and make some hypotheses on the dispersion, the standard deviation for those space-time grains. So we take another parameter, A naught. So we have alpha, which is the power law, and A naught, which is the amplitude, and they put a dependence from energy and momentum like that, parametrized with amplitude and simple power law exponent. So we have a simple model, a very rough model that doesn't keep in account all other possible effects, violation, etc. So it's very basic models of fluctuations. And you take the first order fluctuation, of course. So it is very rough. And we remember from the literature, it is all the literature, that we have 3 main classes, we can say, of phenomenological models of the space-time foam. So one is the random walk model that Giovanni wrote, and I think it was who started this model, where random perturbation of space-time add incoherently with a square root dependence or a more general distribution function. And this is related to space-time foams that recall Bekenstein-Hawking's holographic principle. So if this falls, I was warned by a theoretician, this doesn't mean that the holographic principle falls. It is, it means that you have to adjust better some parameters, of course, because it is not so deep in theory, this approach. And then you have the standard quantum gravity model. So what do these forms do to photons? The foam structure imprints a random perturbation on the photon arrival time. So you have a sort of effect in a turbulent medium. And a distant source may have its light affected, and so you don't have a plane wave coming through, but a distorted wavefront. So, or classically, as usually you do when you study telescopes without quantum mechanics, you can say that the dispersion can see two waves from two distant points of the telescope that interfere with each other and have differently fluctuating velocities that when they cross the space, and they arrived dephased at the detectors or detector of the telescope. So let's put some parameters and scales to make an experiment. So we have an electromagnetic wave or a photon as a ruler. So lambda, the wavelength of the photon, is the smallest scale where you have where you can define group and phase velocity. So you have a phase, etc. So the main scale is the photon wavelength. Then you have energy fluctuations that are related to time of arrival fluctuations. So you have a loss of coherence, so the blurring of your diffraction image that you expect to have from those models, the wavelength, and the parametrization of this sort of phenomenological approach. So you can have this dependence from the distribution and essentially the amplitude. Here is the Planck scale, and this is the distance that the photon traveled to reach our telescope. So it is quite a simple model because we prefer to use a simple model, simple mathematics, because as you will see, the problem of getting data, thought it was my mobile, I forgot to shut it off, sorry. And the problem of getting out very good data is very, it was very hard. It was 3 years of hard work. So those effects can be detected either from Michelson interferometer, so measuring the fringes generated from a star from two apertures, or use, as Ragazzoni et al. Proposed in 2003, to use the whole aperture of the telescope as an interferometer and study the ring structure of Airy disks with a diffraction-limited telescope. And we see that Airy rings are still observed even if the accumulated, only when the accumulated phase is less than 2 pi, of course, which is quite trivial. So this is the first approach with Ragazzoni, Turato, and Gessler, that they adopted the approach of Liu Hillman and used the Hubble Space Telescope images of a far supernova, but and the Hubble Deep Field Galaxy. And they found a strange result at that times. So how it works? This is the aperture of the telescope. It doesn't matter whether it is a mirror or a lens in this moment. What is fundamental is that you limit the space of your wavelength, of your wavefront, by an aperture. So you are creating then a diffraction figure on the focal plane. But if a light source at a distance, at a given distance f, from the center of the telescope aperture is disturbed. The distance between L1 and L2, the distance between the source and the two extreme positions of the aperture of the telescope generate two different points. So the image is not only, it doesn't become only one point and the interference structure. It starts being blurred, so a superposition of diffraction images. So you lose the coherence of your planar wave. The first approach, it was quite brutal and rude. So they took some Milky Way stars, for which you think there is no accumulation of those effects of space-time blurring, and a far supernova. And simply they magnified and subtracted the central peak of the point spread function of the diffraction image, and they observed that there are still airy rings. So the coherence of the light from a star in our galaxy or from a supernova, far isolated supernova, at I don't remember how many parsecs, gigaparsec of distance, are the same. So with that theory, with that model, they were able to discard, let's say, with that parameterization, random walk, holography, and alpha equal one, so Planck scales. So that is something that doesn't work, essentially. So how we can reconcile with the results from quantum gravity? Let's recall again the theory. One half, it is the random perturbation, random walk model, holographic two-thirds, and alpha equal one, the standard quantum gravity model. So all of them were discarded by a supernova. So the supernova is 16.9 megaparsec distant. So it is not even so far like quasars. The idea that, if I remember well, NG et al. Had was to put a compensation effect to the dephasing of photons. So in this way, you could say you have a blurring, but there is a compensation to this blurring by parametrizing in a better way all the dispersion function. So as far as I understand, it is a sort of coming back with the calculations and parameters, a sort of mathematical trick, in my opinion, but maybe it is because I am not so deep in this theory. So another interesting work is the limits that were dictated by using the software of Hubble Space Telescope, the usual software that was developed for the analysis of the diffraction images of Hubble. So here, with those, with their results, they weren't able to discard the alpha two-third model. And with the compensation effects, only the random walk model was discarded by the experimental results. There was a work by Steinbrink in 2007 who made an analysis with the software of Hubble Space Telescope of all these farthest quasars. And from that, they were not able to discard also the model that recalls the holographic principle. So the best result was alpha should be not 0.666, but 0.65. So this is the effect, how you can see photons, quasar, and the blurring. It was for a didactical purpose, essentially. Now, our work was new software. So it was a software which was going to be developed for better astrometry, to get the better position of the sky or the stars in the sky with Hubble Space Telescope. And we used that and improved a lot the software in the search for quantum gravity blurring. So let's use also this new software for quantum gravity and see if we get some new result. So here we have the classical diffraction image with the ID rings and the central peak. And this is the effect that you expect to observe if there is some blurring. So our aims were, let's take a more refined approach. Let's go deeply inside the images of the fastest quasars that Hubble has. They are 151 quasars, and analyze one by one in several sectors the point spread function, the diffraction image of each of the quasars, and see whether they have evolutionary effects, how they, if they disappear, to compare at the same distance from us, at the same Z, if there are differences from quasar to quasar, from point to point of the sky, and make all the cross correlation possible, and then compare with this new software, not to have only, yes, I see the ID diffraction ring, or not, I don't see any diffraction ring. Let's go on the diffraction rings and surf the all the rings that we observed and then compare with what we expect. Because the publicly available TinyTIM software for HST, as that you can find here, is a sort of compromise to what an astronomer needs. So you don't need to have a fantastic precision like in the search of quantum gravity effects. You need to know that here this is a supernova, or here you have a galaxy and you have some position, etc. To go further, you have to improve the software and develop, build up a routine, essentially. So a better precise measurement means new software. And those are some troubles that TinyTIM has. So diffraction spikes when you subtract the central peak of the diffraction image, some spikes remain. So you don't have the enough precision to look at the disturbances that could be induced by quantum gravity. And one problem is the presence of spiders, which means it is a structure, a cross structure, that keeps the secondary mirror of the telescope in its position. Then the telescope has a lot of problems. So it is diffraction limited, but it moves. So there is the Bradley aberration. And you have also other effects. So also the tidal effects. When the moon is close, or it is pointing like that, closer to the Earth, it breathes, they call. So it is deformed. And you see this deformation too. So you have to take in account a lot of things that the program usually doesn't do. And then you have to also to take in account the problem of the convolution in 3x3 points of very faint sources, like quasars. And you have to develop a new interpolating function, et cetera, that we did. So we studied the setup of a Hubble Space Telescope and then determined directly the optical aberration by using stars, galactic stars, supernovae, and other point-like sources. So we mapped all the CCD plus filter setups of Hubble. So this is the flat field of Hubble. How you can see without flat fielding the image with the filter in infrared and the filter in more in the visible band. So you see that you have a lot of disturbances and you must keep in account of that. So the best way of doing is to use the images drizzled, which means corrected by motion, deformation, etc., and improve fertility those images By observing, we observed 4,000 stars with the two setups in the fields and determined point by point, so practically point by point with a computer, the deformation, the optical aberration, that point of the detector with the telescope deformed in a way, and made a model of the detector. So the drizzled images are, for example, those images corrected by the aberration. So you have some software, a pipeline, that takes out all the problems made by cosmic rays. You clean up, but this is deformed. So you have to counter deform by the movement, the aberration, the motion of the telescope, because the telescope is very fast when it is moving through the sky. And you have to keep in account that you don't do only one image, a shot image, but you do a superposition, one orbit, two orbits, three orbits. A friend of mine, Bob Williams, who was the head of a Hubble Space Telescope, the one who did the Hubble Deep Field, they took months, years, to get the Hubble Deep Field, and that picture was costing more than $1 million. For efforts, etc., to get all those information. It was very hard work. So we improved this, we improved this pipeline. By using those corrections. This is a test that you can find in the Advanced Camera for Surveys of Hubble. And then we took those targets from Richards, 147 quasars at this distance, for the other four sources, and the luminosity distances was from a concordance universe model, so nothing special, so the most basic things that we can get to have control of our software, essentially. So we defined the Strehe ratio, which gives you the quality of the diffraction image by this fraction, maximum source divided by the theoretical expected model. And this is a sort of extrapolation that depends on the accumulated phase of multiplied by the telescope diameter and the scale, which is given by the photon wavelength. So here comes into the play telescope, wavelength, and the quantum gravity, if makes some change on photons. So the phase variations can be done caused by optical aberration, evolution of the quasars, and quantum gravity. We tested with the galactic stars and obtained the optical aberration. Galactic stars with the same magnitude, the same color as the quasar, calibrated, etc., etc. So we were able to control this parameter, and then we had these two linked together. The only way to get rid of those two was to cross-correlate at each Z, in an interval of Z, two different points of the sky, and see if there were different effects. So we put some limits also on that. And we used this function, which keeps in account also the residual distortions in the drizzled image of with respect to the position of the star or of the quasar in the detector. And with a recursive search, with a genetic algorithms, we were able to fit up and calculate the optical aberration with an error less than 1%, which is quite good because we had 10% or 12% previously. So the problem was also of determining the position of the maximum of the PSF, so where is the source? And we used this sort of nightmare of procedure to calculate experimentally all these PSF main peak. And we tested the software in with different sources. So determined the optical aberration and tested with the supernovae, isolated supernovae and other peculiar point-like sources. This is an example of what you can see from a raw star. So you have a star in 3x3 pixel and you can divide a pixel in subpixels regions. This is the raw model. Then you adapt, then you correct this model with a recursive function and get the residuals. So this is a sample of 40 stars, 36 stars over the 400 stars that we got where we got all the information about the phase variation due to the optical aberrations. And those are the point spread functions of isolated supernovae that we adopted from the Strolger et al. Survey. So this is a single star. Single star means the model of optical aberration and what you see from supernovae. So we needed a further correction. Before the optimization, putting together all the point spread functions, and after 3 weeks of computation, we were able to get a good model of a point spread function with a 3 supernovae and with the expected point spread function. So the deviations were quite small. And this was the model with the random walk PSF. But this was not enough. So we had to do the same thing for the other filter and the other setup and use another test for this filter plus setup. It was for the other 3 quasars at very big distances. And then we went through quasars. This is the quasar image. And this is what we extracted after our optimization. Okay, and this is what happens when you have the student. We put our student to search manually one by one of the 151 quasars to divide them by 16, measure all the things. So he got sort of a bad reaction after that, and he went to study neutron stars after that. And this is what we found with quasars. We found essentially that there are some evolutionary effects. But averaging this with only one quasar, you cannot get any information about quantum gravity if you are able to discard the alpha two-third model. So we do an interpolation, so we can think to average over 100 of measurement the effect of evolution. And then this is an example of how we handled the image. So this is the center of the quasar, interpolated, subtracted, and then there is the study of the residuals as the software did. More precisely, this is this is the start of X and Y sections of the point spread function, the initial profile, and the residuals, and the measured intensity in certain pixel sections. So it works quite well, this software. And to estimate the phase and stray ratio, we use the usual relationship that I showed you before. And we cannot separate evolutionary plus quantum gravity. That's the problem. And those are determined by the software. So This I told you before, that some quasars may look blurred at the same Z, but we also kept in account that there is a cosmological expansion that subtracts a sort of blurring. And those are the results. So all the experimental results after 2.5 years, this is the linear interpolation. With this is with the redshift, you still have some uncertainties. And here is without redshift, keeping in account the redshift with that model of universe. This sort of jump is due to the change of the two filters, because this works better in the infrared, because they are very far from. And we were able to discard the holographic model with a value of 0.64 with 85.5 confidence level, and the minimum we had was here with 83.3% confidence level without expansion. The survivors were holographic model for alpha naught, A naught less than 5 × 10⁻², or random walk model 10⁻¹³ as amplitude. In conclusion, we did not find any blurring effect with the new software. So, and with the 3 sigma confidence level, we were able to discard part of the, let's call, holographic scenario. I'm sorry if I'm not so precise in the terms of quantum gravity, but it is the rough models that we used. We didn't even observe magnification of quasar images. And either the universe is very flat, or quasars may have some unknown evolutionary effects at larger Z. So this is what we did in 3 years' time. And then we are waiting for an input from you, that you handle very well this theory, to have some suggestions or to say, well, it is very rough, but it was the only way to get some numbers. That's why we used this very rough approach. That's all.
I wanted to ask you just to elaborate a bit more on the final point, actually, because I had followed your work on the fuzziness, but I had not realized there were these implications for...
Let's see if I can...
Just
get,
on okay. Your conclusions.
Conclusions?
The magnification of QSO images that was not found. Does it have significant implications?
No, it was for astronomers. They asked.
No, for astronomers. Does it have, even counting astronomers as meaningful?
Well, we expect to see a magnification if omega is much less than one, essentially. That's why we put that note. So it seems that the universe is flat. This is a very rude assertion. So those are simple numbers, and if you have some suggestions, are very welcome, also because we can improve better the software and get much more information with the JWST that will be launched I don't know when. Okay, what is that?